today I decided that I wanted to talk about two problems that I find very fun, one of which I worked on for a bit, the other one which I've done a lot of looking into but haven't actually worked on it. I know that I listed three problems in my abstract, we're only going to focus on the first two. So the two that I want to focus on are the following. One, how many vectors can you have in d-dimensional space such that among any triple, there is a pair that are orthogonal? So essentially saying, I want to pack as many vectors as I can into d-dimensional space such that they're fairly orthogonal from each other, but not completely orthogonal. And the second question I want to ask is, how many lines in RD can there be that pass through the origin and cross at the same interval? So every pair of lines, we can just look at the angle at which they cross, always take the one that's less than 90 degrees, and I want every pair of lines to cross at the same angle. These are so-called equiangular lines, and I want to know how many of these I could possibly have in d-dimensions. Well, so let's pop into the first question. So, first question. Let's see here. Let's call this number, I don't know, how about T of D? That makes sense, because essentially what we're doing is we're looking at a triangle-free graph. We're looking at embedding a triangle-free graph into d-dimensional space. In some sense, well, what we could do is we could let G be the graph on the vectors. Where uv is an edge of g if and only if the inner product of u and v is not zero. So essentially we could draw a graph on these vectors that is kind of the non-orthogonality relationship. We'll put a line between two of these vectors if they happen to not actually be orthogonal to each other. So what are we really asking? Well, we want g to be triangle. Hence the T of D. We want to know how many of these vectors we can embed into RD, such that if we draw on this non-orthogonality graph, it has no triangles. Well, this kind of leads us to a silly upper bound, doesn't it? Well, what could the independence number of G be? Well, I mean, if we have an independent set, that corresponds to a mutually orthogonal set. Right, pairwise orthogonal guys. So any independent set in G is pairwise orthogonal. Let's just say perpendicular. So actually, because we only are dealing with d-dimensional vectors, we know that the independence number of G can be at most d plus 1. Can't have d plus 1 mutually orthogonal vectors inside of this guy. Well, so now we get to apply some Ramsey, right? We know that g does not have a triangle, and it doesn't have an independent set of size d plus 1. So we know that T of D, just kind of trivially, is at most the Ramsey number 3 d plus 1. Because once you're bigger than this, you're forced to either have a triangle or have an independent set of size d plus 1. So we get a bad upper bound, R3D, this is, let's see, R3D is on the order of d squared over 1. So we know right away that we have to have some quadratically many vectors. Okay. Well, can we do better? Well, there's an easy lower bound on T of D as well, right? All we want to make sure is that if we pick any three of the vectors, two of them are orthogonal. So one construction we could do is say, well, take two orthogonal bases. Well, if we pick any three vectors from two orthogonal bases, well, two of them have to come from the same orthogonal basis and are orthogonal. So we get a lower bound of T of D is at least 2D. So we know the answer is somewhere between linear and slightly less than quadratic. Fantastic. But if you play around with it a while, let's look at a small case here. What's the answer in two dimensions? Sometimes small cases are useful. Well, we know we could have at least four vectors, right? Two orthogonal bases. But in fact, once we have at least three vectors, two of them have to be orthogonal. So without loss of generality, we could say like E1 and E2 is inside our set. But now, if we have at least two other vectors, they have to actually be mutually orthogonal. Say that I had two other vectors which weren't orthogonal, not 90 degrees, then in fact, there's one of these guys that they're also not orthogonal to parallelize. So we can take this vector, that vector, and that guy, and have a triple that doesn't have an orthogonal parallel. So in fact, the only thing in two dimensions you can do is take two orthogonal bases. So we know T of 2 is actually exactly 4. Well, let's try to bootstrap this argument a little bit. We actually notice the following thing, that if V, these are set of vectors, has an orthogonal basis, we see one orthogonal basis for the space inside there, then in fact it must be exactly two orthogonal bases. By the same argument, pick two vectors that aren't orthogonal, that's not in this basis, there must be one guy in this basis that isn't orthogonal to either of them. Then V must, in fact, be two.
Wait, how does this, in higher dimensions, how does this go?
Well, we could ask the same question. Fix your orthogonal, by assumption we have an orthogonal basis, right? Okay. Well, we know that we have some other number of vectors, at least, you know, D others, okay. Right? Well, if it's not an orthogonal basis, that rest of them, pick two of them which aren't orthogonal.
Which are orthogonal.
Wait a second. This is a basis for my space, right? Can both of these be, sorry, can all of these vectors be orthogonal to one of the two? No, because they're both not orthogonal to each other. It's a bit of a geometry argument. You can do it by, the real way to do it is to write those two as linear combinations in the orthogonal basis, which you can do by just projecting them onto that space. And then you get a contradiction just by writing things out. I'd rather not do that. But that's how the formal argument goes. But it's essentially the same idea, is that if I have two of these vectors, I can't actually find any, well, I can find one vector among the other bases that's not orthogonal to either of them. Okay. Well, so actually, this allows us to figure out the answer for three dimensions. Why? Well, what's R33? That's 6, right? Okay. So if if V is, say, in R3 and has at least 6 vectors, then G, the non-orthogonality graph that we draw on V, either has a triangle or a basis, or an orthogonal basis. Well, we know it doesn't have a triangle, so it must have an orthogonal basis, which means that everything not inside of G must also be an orthogonal. So everything not inside of this orthogonal basis must also be an orthogonal basis. So the only thing that we can have as well as T of 3 is 6. And we've actually shown that, well, in two dimensions, the only thing you can do is take two orthogonal bases Additionally, in three dimensions, the only thing you can do is take two orthogonal bases. We could ask the same question about four, but I'm not sure what the answer is. My guess is that the answer is still the same for d equals four, because R3-4 is 9. You can't actually get 9, and we'll discuss why that is. But my guess is that you only have to check a few examples, and maybe you could find a proof that says in four dimensions, it also has to be 2. Well, so let's make a conjecture. I mean, we did small cases, and small cases do everything by induction, right? All you need is a base case, and it works. The induction's always the easy part, isn't it? So, conjecture. Maybe all you can do is 2. Certainly the case for 2, also it was true for 1 dimension, but 1 dimension is stupid. No one likes 1 dimension. Except for undergrads.
But
how could we prove this? Well, one thing that we kept noticing is that maybe the only thing you can do is take 2 orthogonal bases. We showed that that was the case for d equals 2 and d equals 3. We didn't show it was the case for d equals 4, but it feels like it should be close to being right, because the Ramsey number is 9, and we conjecture that you can only have 8 vectors. But unfortunately, this isn't true. This is something I struggled with. When I was trying to prove this problem, I struggled for a while trying to show that you had to have 2 bases. In other words, show that the non-orthogonality graph has to be bipartite. They're the same thing in this case. Well, unfortunately, in 5D, you can do other things. So let's construct 10 vectors that don't contain an orthogonal basis among them. Well, one thing we could do is we could start with the vector, I'm just going to not write the tuples, I'm just going to write them. Let's say 1, 1, 0, 0, 0. And then we could do, write them in kind of a circle for reasons. So let's draw some edges if they happen to not be orthogonal. What we notice is that every pair that's right next to each other are in fact orthogonal, right? These aren't orthogonal in kind of a five-cycle fashion on the inside. Also, these aren't orthogonal again in a five-cycle fashion on the outside. And in fact, we have all these cross edges. That is not orthogonal. That one is orthogonal. This is a very poorly drawn graph. But essentially what it looks like is if you take a 5-cycle and you blow up every vertex into an independent set of size 2, and then just carry it around the edges. Again, this is hard to look at, but this graph has a 5-cycle. It's not bipartite, so in fact it cannot contain an orthogonal basis of this space. However, there is no triangle in this graph. And we have 10 vectors. So maybe you want to go and check it. But in 5 dimensions, and in fact this works in any odd dimension, you can construct examples of 2D vectors that have this 2 out of 3 property, yet don't contain an orthogonal basis. That's a bit of a killer. So maybe this conjecture is not true. But it is. So it's actually a theorem, originally proved by, I wrote this down, Rosenfeld in 91. When I was working on this, I didn't realize this had been proved, nor had I realized it was a conjecture of Erdős's from a long time ago. I did track down, after I had a proof, Rosenfeld's proof, and it's not pretty, it's not fun, it's gross. I have a very nice simple proof of this fact, and I'd like to share it. Okay. Who's ready for a nice simple proof? Hoo-hoo, I love pretty proofs. Pretty proofs are the absolute best. Okay. So what are we going to do? We're really going to exploit this triangle freeness, and then we're just going to do some averaging in Cauchy Schwartz, because Cauchy Schwartz is the best inequality ever. Okay. So the first thing I want to do is I want to prove the following statement. So let's let n of v be the neighborhood of v, the neighborhood of the vector in the graph. So just the guys that it's connected to, and by a connection that means it's not orthogonal to it. So the key point is we don't have any triangles, so in fact n of v is an independent set. Set in G, simply because we don't have any triangles. So in fact, all of these guys in the neighborhood of any given vector are going to be mutually orthogonal. Fantastic. So let's write down one inequality. Let's let n star of V be the extension, be an extension of n of V to an orthogonal basis. Okay. So, I mean, it's already orthogonal. We can just extend it to an orthogonal basis of R d. Well, but now it's an orthogonal basis. Let's pretend everything is a unit vector from here on, okay? Just to make our lives easier. Well, then we can write V. So we know that V, well, it's going to be equal to the sum over all u in this extension of the inner product of u with v times u. And that's just projecting v onto this orthogonal basis. Okay, fantastic. So now let's actually figure out what the length of v is, the norm of v. I mean, we know it's 1, right? We pretended everything was a unit vector. So this is the norm of v squared. But now, this is just v dotted with v. So we can write this as v sum of all u in the extended neighborhood of v, of u of v times u, which multiplying across is just the sum over all u in the extended neighborhood of v of the inner product of u with v squared. Fantastic. And now, well, these are all non-negative numbers. Let's just forget the things in the extended neighborhood and just look at the guys in the original neighborhood. So in fact, if you add up the inner products of V with all of the guys in the neighborhood squared, you're always going to get at most 1. And this is just nothing interesting. We just use the triangle free property to guarantee that this guy was in fact mutually orthogonal, so we can extend it. All right. So now, let's look at the following. So we need the following inequality. So the claim, little inequality, short proof. Let's let A be an n by n matrix symmetric. Then the trace of A squared is bigger than or equal to the trace of A squared divided by the rank of A. So we're going to need this inequality. It's the crucial point in our proof. Yes. No, this may not actually be equal, because this extension to a basis, it may not have anything to do with our original set, right? So u, no, this should just be a bigger than or equal to, because we lost some vectors and those could have been strictly positive. There's no reason that it couldn't be. Right, we took the neighborhood of v, we blew it up to an to a full orthogonal basis, right? We have no idea how v interacts with the vectors that we threw in.
Oh, okay, because the basis is not in the set.
No, the basis isn't actually in the set. We just took its neighborhood and extended it to some orthogonal basis, or just so we could get this.
Even without the extension, it's just projecting v onto the subspace spanned by the neighbors.
Yeah, essentially. It's hard for me to think about. This is easy for me to think about, because these are non-negative, so you can throw them away. Maybe that's a better way to think. But this is going to be a key inequality right here. But this is just Cauchy Schwartz. let's give a quick proof. I love this inequality, as it's super useful and has worked well for me on lots of different problems. Okay. Well, what's the trace of a squared? Well, this is just the sum of the eigenvalue squared, so lambda 1 squared, all the way out to lambda squared of the rank, right? The rest of them are going to be 0. Fantastic. Now we just apply Cauchy-Schwarz. The sum of the squares is at least this is at least 1 over the number of these guys, which is the rank of A, of lambda 1 out to lambda rank A squared. Wait, but this is just the trace. Fantastic. Really short and sweet, and it's just Cauchy-Schwarz. That's going to be good. Yes?
Do you have any other explanation of that?
My guess is that you probably should be able to get it from some sort of functional inequality. I mean, because really you're just kind of looking at symmetric form. I don't have another explanation. There should be another one by looking at the matrix as a function. Because this inequality is actually true even if you have like an infinite. This inequality still holds, but I'm not quite sure how to prove it. And this is a very nice, clean proof.
Yeah. Wait, so just to remind me, because my linear algebra is rusty, so since A is symmetric, we know that all the eigenvalues are going to have, like,
real.
They're real and they have multiplicity 1.
No, these may be some of the same.
Okay, they're duplicate.
I'm just saying, like, I mean, what's the trace of a matrix? It's the sum of its eigenvalues. The eigenvalues of the square of a matrix are the squares of the eigenvalues, whether you're symmetric or not. But because all of them are real, now I get to use, like, inequalities. Fantastic. You happy? Okay. But this is going to be important. Now, bootstrapping it with this guy, we're going to be done. So, big proof. All we're going to do is we're going to look at the sum over all u and v inside of our big set of vectors, the inner product of u and v squared. We're going to provide an upper and lower bound for these. Upper bound first, using this guy. Let's call this inequalities. Well, one thing I could do is I could write this as the sum over all v in v, sum over all u in v, of the inner product of u and v squared, easy enough. Well, let's see here. This is going to be the sum over v in v. We get a 1 when v is with itself, plus right? Wait a second. But v is orthogonal to anything that's not in its neighborhood. So we're going to end up getting a 0 most of the time. So this is actually equal to the sum over all v in the big V of 1 plus the sum over all the u in the neighborhood of v, inner product u with v squared. Wait, but we have an inequality on this. So by star, this is less than or equal to the sum of 2, which is twice the number of vectors we have. Fantastic. So that's an upper bound. Now we're going to use this guy for a lower bound. All right. So lower bound, let's first notice that let's let A be the Gram matrix. Of V. All that means is that we're just going to list all of the inner products. So I need A U V is just going to be the inner product of U with V. Easy enough. I'm going to erase this inequality because we're done with it. Alright. Well, one thing to notice is that the sum over all u and v in our vector set of uv squared, this is just equal to the trace of a squared. Fantastic, because it's symmetric. Okay, well now we can use this inequality. It's bigger than or equal to the trace of a squared over the rank of a. All right, I want to give one more inequality. We would know what the trace of a is, right? It's just the size of V. So we get the size of V squared. Now what's say an upper bound Well, they all of these vectors live in d-dimensional space, right? So the rank of A is at most d. Fantastic. So what do we know, putting these two things together? We know that twice b is bigger than or equal to b squared over d, which is the same thing as saying that b is at most d plus d. Very nice. I like this problem. It's very pretty. And very simple. Rosenfeld's original proof was not pretty. For some reason, he decided to look at the trace of a cube of A and do all these weird inequalities with like triples of eigenvalues, and it was disgusting, and I don't understand why it works. I understand why this works. So in fact, we now have a full answer. T of B is always 2B. Very nice and simple. So one thing that I'd like to say about this is there's a natural extension of this type of question, just normal Ramsey questions in this field, which is how many vectors could you have if among any k of them there was an orthogonal pair. So we just asked among any three of them there's an orthogonal pair. What if you just extend this natural Ramsey sense to any k of them, right? So now we're avoiding k-cliques and independent sets of d plus 1. Well, you can't hope for any nice answer. I'm not going to prove this at all, but a theorem by Alone and Zagetti 99 showed that actually, let's call it a T sub K of D. They showed that there exists some positive delta such that for every K, that this is always bigger than or equal to, and I wrote it down, D to the delta log K over log log. So in fact, it grows polynomial. Or as k goes to infinity, it grows exponentially, I mean, whichever way you want to think about it. This delta is actually meant perfectly to balance out what happens when like k equals 3, essentially. So that way you get. Yes?
Hi, Klaus. I'm thinking about the case when we can achieve the maximum.
Uh-huh.
Because the second part of the proof seems to be easy to make the inequality to be equality.
Right, like, so you need all the eigenvalues to be the same.
Right, and for the first part, it seems that in order to achieve to the sum of like u v and about a square should just be equal to 1. And that means
right.
For each of that,
it means that it would mean that a v would have to be orthogonal to everything that's not in its neighborhood, right? Which is exactly the situation that you get into when you have two orthogonal bases, right? If I fix one vector, its neighborhood is exactly the other basis, and it's orthogonal to everything that's not in there, namely the first orthogonal basis, right? And then if you have an orthogonal basis, or a pair of orthogonal bases, let's verify that this works out. I guess you don't quite, I guess it's not so easy to see that all the eigenvalues are the same in that case, is it? But
I guess for the second part, all the numbers on the trace are 1.
Yeah, I guess both of them, but now the sum of all d's, is that one? I guess with the orthogonal basis, you could argue. I'm not sure how you'd argue with the other example that I gave, and I'm also not sure how many types of examples there could be that don't. My guess is that there could be tons of them. Like, I gave one example of something that's not an orthogonal basis, two orthogonal bases, and that works in any odd dimension. My guess is that you could come up with lots of kind of group actions and build a graph out of those, and it'll be gross. So my guess is that you won't be able to get any real structure out of this. At least I tried to at first, but it's not true. Yeah. I mean, I actually came up with this proof first and then realized that you can't always have two orthogonal bases. I came out of it by trying to analyze what just happened to this guy and realized that there's no reason it doesn't tell you anything.
Okay.
Questions? let's go into the second problem. So this was a fun problem. I like this problem a lot. You have lots of vectors for k larger. There's also an upper bound. I forgot to write it down. But it just doesn't seem quite as interesting to me, at least. There's lots of weird things going on, and I don't understand what should be going on. Okay, so the second question, we wanted to ask, how many lines could we have in d dimensions such that they all cross at the same angle, all pass through the origin and cross at the same angle? So the same question is asking, how many unit vectors can you have in RD such that for every, I guess, u not equal to v in your collection of vectors, the inner product of u with v is always plus or minus alpha. Let's just normalize alpha to be the positive one, so let's say the absolute value is equal to alpha. So this is really the question about these equiangular lines, right? Because, well, for any line, you can take either its plus or its minus, and you should normalize it to always be taking kind of the smaller angle. Okay. Well, one dimension's easy. I like one dimension sometimes. I know I said it was only for undergrads. Sometimes it's easy to think about. I don't know, does anyone have call it EQ of D, equiangular?
Sure.
Let's call this number EQ of D. Okay, well, EQ of 1. How many lines could you have passing through the origin in 1D such that they all intersect at the same angle? Well, there's only one line in one dimension. That's easy. Maybe the answer is always 1. That would be great. I claim that we can get at least constructions. This is at least 3 in 2 dimensions, and this is easy to see. Let's draw a regular hexagon and take the lines. Do I have colors? Apparently not. Let's take the lines that pass through opposite vertices. If you take those lines, they all intersect at the same angle. So you can get at least 3 of them in 2 dimensions. EQ of 3, you can get at least 6. And this is the same construction with the opposite vertices of the icosahedron. Okay. There's one other nice one. EQ of 7 is at least 28. You know, just to be a bit random, let's give a construction. Let's actually look at 8 dimensions for a second. Let's consider all of the vectors v in R8 with, let's let vij for ij, an element in bracket 8 choose 2. Note that 8 choose 2 is equal to 28. With 3 in position I and j, and minus 1 elsewhere. So for example, like V34, V the vector -1, -1, position 3 has a 3, position 4 has a 3, and the minus 1's everywhere else. Is that enough? Yeah. So let's claim that these are actually equiangular. Note that there are, again, 8 choose 2 of them, which is 28. Well, if you take the inner product of any 2 of them, let's not worry about them being unit. Well, either the 3's completely miss each other, right? In which case, the 3's will end up canceling out, and you'll get
what?
You'll get 4, correct? Okay. Otherwise, they share 1, 3, in which case you're gonna get a 9, the other 3's are gonna cancel out, and then you're going to get what?
3's not canceling out.
Yeah, the 3's
oh, no, the 3's both in. Oh, yeah, right, you get a minus 6, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic, so you get a 9 minus 6, okay, and then plus just 1, right? Because 3's are
there. Wait, each 3 will contribute the minus, so it minus 12.
No, you have 2 of them lining up, right? So you get a 9 there. three times three.
In the case where
and then the other two threes are somewhere else, so they both contribute a minus three because they're multiplied by a minus one, right?
And then we're getting a plus five
plus
from the
five,
minus,
right?
Plus five from the other minus ones.
Okay, so what is this?
This is four. If the threes totally miss each other, we'll have a minus 12 contribution.
Yeah, it'll be a minus 12 plus 4 in the other case.
Minus 12 plus 4?
So one is minus 8 and the other is plus 8.
Okay, great, but they're the same. I can't do arithmetic. I can't do arithmetic. Okay, I'm really bad at this, but let's pretend they work. Okay, but you should be unhappy with me because I said that they should be in R7, not R8. But now you notice that they're all actually orthogonal to the all ones vector. Right? So really they live in R7. So really, these live in R7. Okay. Because they're all orthogonal to the all ones vector. The sum of any one of them is zero. So in fact, we can just kind of rotate the all ones vector down to wherever you want it to be. But it's easier to write them down in a sense. Okay. So we gave like four examples. Fantastic. It turns out that EQ of 4 is also at most 6. I mean, clearly it's modular, right? Sorry, not modular.
Monotone.
Monotone. Thank you. I claim that all of these are in fact equalities. Although we won't prove this one. This one, I don't know why it's true. It just turns out that you can't do any better in R4 than you can R3. So let's ignore that. But let's actually prove that all of these are equalities. Alright. So instead, what we'll actually do is we'll show the following. What do we call this? EQ. EQ of D is always at most D plus 1 choose D. Note that all of these have the form D plus 1 choose D. So let's prove that this is a general upper bound. Unfortunately, this upper bound, it's not known whether or not it can be tight infinitely often. In fact, there is only one other case, as far as I'm aware, which is like, I think 28 or 29 or 27, one of those three, where again we can get a construction and it's gross. But as far as opposed to those ones, I'm pretty sure that no one knows whether or not any others exist that achieve. Well, let's give a proof. And the proof is very pretty, very linear algebraic, and I love it. So here's what we're going to do. Let's let x1 through just some xn, we're going to get a bound on n later, be unit vectors in d-dimensional space, elements of the sphere, d minus 1, that are equiangular, so let's suppose with, let's say that the absolute value of the inner product of xi, xj is always equal to alpha when I is not equal to j. They're all unit vectors, so they have inner product 1 with themselves. Okay. We're going to use a rank argument again, a dimension argument. And here's the claim. The projection matrices x1, x1 transpose through xn, xn transpose are linearly independent. Well, this automatically gives you the upper bound of d plus 1 choose 2. Namely, these are all symmetric matrices. They're linearly independent, so we could have at most the dimension of the symmetric matrix space, which is d plus 1 choose 2. Fantastic. So if we can show this, we get the upper bound for free. Everyone happy? People unhappy. This is very clever, and I love it. Okay. Well, let's show that they're linearly independent. I mean, come on, freshman algebra. Okay. Well, suppose.
Really independent in what space?
In the space of symmetric matrices.
The space of symmetric matrices, where you just look above the diagonal or the diagonal.
I mean, I don't care. These are matrices, right?
Okay.
Right. I mean, x1 column matrix. So it would be a d by d matrix, and it's symmetric. So we're just going to show they're linearly independent. So we know that their dimension, you know, the number of them can't be larger than the dimension of the space that they could span, that they live in, right?
I see.
Which is the symmetric matrix space, D by D.
Okay.
Which has how many free variables? We get to pick everything, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to D, which is D plus 1 choose 2. Is everyone happy? All we have to do is show that they're linearly independent. suppose that there exists some C1 up through CN with, you know, normal jazz. C1, X1, X1 transpose out to CN, XN, XN transpose equal to 0. We just have to show all of them are equal to 0. Woot. We couldn't have done anything other than the stupid thing. Okay. Well, let's get out one inequality. I may not do this the best way. I forgot to read the paper, so I'm just going off of how I did it once. So it might not be the best way to do this. Let's take the trace of both sides. Okay, so let's apply the trace to both sides. Well, what's the trace of x1, x1 transpose? Well, that's the inner product, right? So it's 1. So if I take the trace of both sides, we get that actually these c's actually have to sum to 0. So this is actually an affine. Okay, well, now let's do something more. Why don't we square it and take the trace? I like to do things. Okay. So what is the trace? Well, we know 0 is equal to the trace of this thing squared. If we just write it out, this is the trace of the sum over all I and j. Ci, Cj, Xi, Xi transpose, Xj, Xj transpose. Okay, well, let's see here. What do we want to do? Well, this is the same thing. If we pass the trace in, it's the sum over all I and j, Ci, Cj, times the inner product of Xi, Xj squared. Just passing in the trace inside. Let's separate some things out. So this is certainly the sum over I of Ci squared, right? Taking out all the diagonal terms. But now if we're on the off diagonal, this is alpha. Plus or minus alpha, so we get to square it.
Okay, can we slow down a bit? Why is the trace of that thing the inner product?
Well, Xi transpose things, Xj is the inner product, right?
That's the inner product, okay.
And now trace, you can cyclically shift it this way. So we just get Xi transpose times xj, xj transpose times xi. That's a scalar. We get to ignore the trace. So yeah, we're just using the trace to shift everything around. Okay. Now we get the sum over what? I not equal to j, ci, cj, alpha squared. Right? Because all of these, if I is not equal to j, it's plus or minus alpha. The inner product. You're squaring it. You look unhappy.
The trace is cyclic even when these, because that's xi is a vector, it doesn't live in the right space.
No, it's actually perfectly fine.
You can do the cyclic thing even
if you can do it with any matrices.
Huh.
Mm-hmm. Any matrices, yeah, any matrices. As long as you're allowed to. I mean, the trace has to be done on a square matrix. Right?
Yeah.
So as long as the product both ways is square, you can do it.
Hmm.
Yep. And the product both ways is in fact square between vectors. One way it's n by n, one way it's 1 by 1. So yes, it's actually perfectly fine. Okay. What are we going to do from here? Let's figure it out. I know I figured this out at some point. So let's see. We could write this guy. Let's see here. I don't like the I not equal to j, so let's push it back in. So we can write this as a 1 minus alpha squared, or sum over I of ci squared. Plus sum over all I and j, ci, cj, alpha squared, right? Just push an alpha squared into there. What can we do from here? I want to use this fact, so let's see here. How can we use this fact? Joe, do you remember how I did this?
Yeah, the thing on the right is alpha squared times the sum of the ci's, and like everything is 0. Times the sum of the ci's.
Right, so let's just sum over I and then sum over j, right? Ci, cj, alpha squared. If we pull out the ci here and the alpha squared, we just get the sum of the cj's. But what's the sum of the cj's? This guy is in fact 0. So we get that 1 minus alpha squared times the sum of the ci squareds is 0, over there. Wait a second. Alpha's definitely not plus or minus one, right? I mean, otherwise we have, like, this is stupid. That cancels out, so this implies that it's Caesar City. Fantastic. Cool. We have at most D plus one, choose two of them. Yeah, what's up?
Wait, can you clarify why alpha can't be plus or minus one?
Because that's stupid. If alpha were plus or minus one, right, then we want to make then we could only have one line.
Oh, okay.
Because every vector has to be plus or minus every other vector, right? Because they're inner products one, which means you literally only have one line, and that's stupid. Right? We can do at least better than one line. We can do at least D lines, right? Just by taking them on an orthogonal basis. Ah, so there are most D plus one, choose two. That's fantastic. Ah, such a pretty result. So in fact, for those cases that we just saw, they're type. That's nice. What else is known about this number? I won't actually prove this because it requires futzing a lot with minimal polynomials and algebraic complements of algebraic conjugates, sorry. What's known is that if equality holds, then either d equals 2 or 3, or d plus 2 is the square of an odd number. I'm not going to prove that. It's really futzy and I don't like it. So in fact, this doesn't hold very often. Okay, sure. One. Make you happy, Kevin. That's all I live for. So it is known that it's pretty restrictive. D plus 2 has to be the square of an odd number, and it is unknown in general whether or not that you can achieve equality infinitely often. No one knows. In fact, for a long time, and we might prove this result, I like this result, for a long time, namely Lemons and Seidel, this was in 73, and I believe that this came out in 73 as well, or maybe just a little bit earlier. They showed that EQ of D is at least, let's just say, omega of D to the 3/2, which isn't quite good. I mean, this is quadratic. And this was the state of the art for a while. No one could beat D to the 3/2. We might actually do this construction the first time, because I like this construction. I recently found out how to modify it to get something, which I think is cooler. But anyway. Until recently, the con. So this is a cube construction using projective planes in Hadamard matrices, but isn't too surprising. You kind of throw them together in a way and you use these structural results. But de Kahn in 2000, this result's just kind of a miracle. He showed that EQ of D is at least 2/9 D squared infinitely. And yeah, it's a really short proof, but he piggybacks off of a lot of weird results. Basically saying, oh look, these algebraic combinatorialists have had these matrices floating around forever. We can just plug them in, and it works. It's kind of really amazing that no one had noticed this connection earlier, but they're pretty crazy matrices that I don't understand what they're doing. But it's kind of cool, we now know it's quadratic. But unfortunately, as far as I'm aware, this is state of the art. Any improvements on this, my guess is that it's improving the infinitely often condition. I think D has to be related to a power of 4 somehow to get it to work. Okay. I don't know. How much time do I have, Kevin? Time to go through a construction? I have how much?
Until 7 o'clock.
Oh, cool.
Maybe before the construction. So is there any... so there's new state of the art on the sort of limb soup of this sequence. Is the like limb inf still just d to the 3/2?
No. So by infinitely often, there was a paper not too terribly long ago which showed how you can take a special quadratic construction, which I think in a special case is this. And you could actually use some sort of convexity argument to bootstrap everything up to some sort of curve fitting. So everything is, in fact, quadratic.
Okay.
This constant is worse because you have to bootstrap it up in some way. I don't remember exactly how it works.
You stretch it out and get the lower bounds.
Yeah, so everything is in fact quadratic. I don't know the constant they get, but essentially it's a curve fitting idea using some sort of convexity. I read the paper, but I forget how it worked. They modified de Kahn's construction using mutually orthogonal bases instead of what de Kahn did. Got slightly worse things, but they got to the point where they could actually push it around a little bit into a little bit higher and a little bit lower without using the quadratic. But I don't know exactly how it worked. But yes, I mean, great question. It is always quadratic. So I think it's nice to go through construction, at least the construction of lemons and cycles, especially because I really like this construction. Because it let me solve one of my other problems by varying it a little. So what we're going to do is we're going to start out with a projective plane of order, let's say, q equals a power of 2, order 2 to the I. Do I want 2 to the I? I'm going to instead say 4 to the I. Reason I'm going to do 4 to the I. Wait, now is 2 to the I okay? For Hadamard matrices, do I need powers of 4? Yes, I do. Okay. Not powers of 2, aren't. Okay, whatever. 4 to the I, 2 to the I.
Bigger than 4, I think.
Is it powers of 2? Okay. Great. No, because 1 and 2 work as well. But whatever. It's not important.
Yeah.
Let's say 2 to the I. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to do the following. We're going to write down the point line in this incidence matrix. What's so special about this matrix? Well, it's a projective plane, right? We know that we have q squared plus q plus 1 points and lines, so it's a square matrix of order q squared plus q plus 1. We know that every row has exactly q plus 1 ones. And same thing with every column. Every column has exactly q plus 1 ones. And lastly, we know that if you intersect any, let's say that these are the lines and these are the points. If you intersect any two lines, you get exactly one point. So any two of these rows share exactly one one in common. Right? All right. Well, this isn't very good. I mean, the dimension is q squared plus q plus 1, right? We're not going to do any better, but we want to blow this thing up. All right, so how are we going to blow it up? Let's take a Hadamard matrix. Of order q. So what's a Hadamard matrix? It's one where transpose, let's say that this is equal to q times the identity matrix, right? Square matrix, it's a plus or minus one matrix. So plus or minus one matrix. That happens to be orthogonal to itself. Okay. So what are we going to do? Let's erase this, not hi. Let's look at H, and let's look at its columns. Let's say the first column is H1, down to the last column is some, I don't know, H, H8, H9, do I care about this? Do I care? Maybe I do. What we're going to do is we're going to go to each of these ones in a row, and we're going to throw in the corresponding column of H. So this is, say, the first one in the row. So you're going to replace this one by the column H1. You're going to replace the second one by the column H2. So on and so forth. Third column by H3, fourth column by H4. And now you have one leftover column. It's just going to be all ones. Any zeros just get blown up as well. I'm trying to remember if we have to avoid an all ones row or not. Yes, we do. So the first row, let's assume that this is all ones, which we can do, and then these guys don't have actually that first row. So we never get a whole row of all ones here. There's always some alternating between plus and minus ones. Okay. The claim is that the rows are actually at random. So first thing, there are roughly q cubed lines living, well, vectors living in r to the q squared, roughly q squared. So this will give us our d to the 3/2 construction. Okay. Q cubed living in q squared, that gives you d to the 3/2. So we just have to verify that they are in fact equal. So let's check. Does every row have the same norm? Yeah, it has exactly q plus 1 non-zero entries. They're all plus or minus 1. So every row actually has norm q plus 1. Right? Well, square root of q plus 1. And exactly q plus 1 non-zero entries. And those are plus or minus 1. So each row has norm equal to the square root. So I'm not really going to care that they're actually unit vectors, but they all have the same norm. So as long as we can verify that they all have the same inner product between them, we're happy. Okay. Well, what happens if I take two rows and take their inner product? What can happen? Well, they either, these two rows came from the same kind of blow-up here, right? Well, what could have happened in this blow-up? Well, take this row and this row. But wait a second. They're going to agree on their first q entries, right? So they share the same ones, or minus ones. But these ones were replaced by a row of the Hadamard matrix. These ones were replaced by a row of the Hadamard matrix. Those two rows are orthogonal. Yes, they're different rows. Okay, so these all zero out and we just get a plus one. So the inner product is equal to plus one if rows came from the same blow up. What if they came from a different blow up? Well, now we're just going to use the following fact that came from the actual projected plane. If these came from two different blow-ups, then in fact, shrinking them down, they came from two different lines of the projected plane. So they intersect in exactly one point. Namely, there is only one point that they share in common where one of them is not zero. Now that's either they alternate in sign or they share the same sign, so it's always going to be. I guess looking at this, I didn't care whether or not that first row is there, the all ones are gone. I guess it didn't really matter. I thought of it. But either way, all of the inner products between these guys are plus or minus one. They all have the same norm, so they're equiangular. How many of them? Well, the dimension is q squared, so d is q squared, so there are d to the 3/2 of them. We have a nice construction. Very pretty construction. But yeah, the question of whether this is 2 to the I or 4 to the I. It's just to make sure that this Hadamard matrix exists, and I forget when it actually exists. It's either powers of 2 or powers of 4 that it automatically exists for. I think powers of 2.
Powers of 2.
It's powers of 2. Okay, good, you know. Great, I always forget. But anyway, it's nice. Hopefully these problems were fun. If you can improve equiangular lines, that'd be fantastic, because it's really a bitch that we don't know. Even if this is achieved infinitely often, it's so annoying. Okay. Anyway, thanks. Questions, comments, concerns, hateful remarks?
So these finite instances where the bound is achieved, it's just totally ad hoc?
Yeah.
How
it really, is. There's no rhyme or reason to it.
That's really disheartening.
Yeah, I forget where the 28-dimensional one comes from, but it's some... I think it's some weird association scheme that it comes from. But yeah, so there was a big push to find equiangular lines, which was essentially trying to find actually where cidal matrices come from, is this problem where you have a graph, you put plus ones, so you put a zero on the diagonal, you put plus ones where there's an edge and minus ones where there is not an edge, and you want to control the eigenvalues, and these matrices, I guess they got picked up by some other algebraic people and they liked them for them, but they were originally for this purpose, as far as I'm aware. because you can get bounce rectangular lines by these plus minus one symmetric matrices.
Yeah. Are there any known values beside those cases?
There are lots of them. So a lot of small cases are known, and they're not very good.
Okay.
For example, I believe there's a pretty large interval around seven dimensions where it's all 28, at least above seven dimensions. Like, I think between like seven and maybe 14 or so dimensions, it's all 28. Yeah, you can't do any better than you can do in seven dimensions. You can look it up on OEIS, or if you look at the original Lemon-Seidel paper, again, it's from the 70s, but they have a list of all of the currently known best results for small dimensions in that paper at that time. But that was, again, 30 years ago, and I don't know small results there. Except for 4, which is still 6. You can't do better than the Akasi.
Yeah, exactly. So what's the motivation for solving this other than
it's pretty? Is there any reason other than it's interesting? I mean, if for some reason you cared about a matrix, a plus minus one matrix, symmetric, that only had 2 eigenvalues, and they were fairly big, and stuff like that, then these equiangular lines are equivalent to these matrices. I'm not sure if people actually care about. So I don't know where the interest sparked from, but a few people have just done work on it. It's kind of expanded into at least the combinatorics community a little bit. It's still a relatively small problem. Not too many people looked at it. I'm not sure if there was an initial motivation behind it, except for the fact that it was interesting. I'm okay just looking. Anything else? Yeah, what's up?
I found that there are a lot of problems in combinatorics that can be articulated in like 10 words and pretty and interesting.
Uh-huh.
Do you have recommendations of such like a small book that introduce those problems better with a short book to some elementary results?
Well, I mean, you know the book Proofs from the Book, right? I mean, that's a great book. It has things other than combinatorics, right? But it has a collection of just very pretty results and incredibly pretty proofs. So I'd look that up. I think you can find a free, at least chapter by chapter copy on the author's website if you forget who it's by. But if you look that up, I know there's like a free copy of that online that you can find, or you can just torrent it like we all do. But yeah, as for other just little problems, I know. I know Noga alone has written a couple short kind of survey papers on pretty problems that just kind of come up in like little geometry or combinatorics things. I forget what those are called though, but he has like a small series of short papers that are just like, here's an interesting problem, here are some results, here's another interesting problem, here are some results. Great. But yeah, pretty problems. But you see, the moral of the story is discrete math equals best math. So. You should really check yourself. Okay. All right. Y'all good? Or am I still on the grill?
All right, let's thank Chris again.
You didn't know.
No, you was particular.
What happens if it comes to the... I don't always want to murder you.
conclusion is your right hand square with probability is tangent. This is where you have at least two sources
right
plus one source. Yes. But you should have been given those. It's like just like maybe more boosting on you to give you the right hand square.
Usually during the semester.
So your probability of success should be higher than 1/2 with some constant. I mean, yeah, sure, if you